let's be quite clear about one thing. Cheryl Crane did not murder Johnny Stompinato, even though that's what most people think they remember happening. She did not falsely confess to killing him to shield her mother, even though many people think that's what happened, and her mother ultimately paid the Stompinato family thousands of dollars in an out-of-court settlement of the unlawful killing suit they brought. As a teenager, Cheryl thrust a knife firmly into the tough hoodlum, and he died where he fell. He was not threatening her, and he had never molested her. But an inquest concluded that this was justifiable homicide. And I think they were quite right. Here's what happened. Cheryl was the only daughter of businessman Joseph Stephen Crane and film star Lana Turner. Discovered in the mid-1930s, in her mid-teens, Lana, born Judy Turner, was dubbed the Sweater Girl because tight cashmere sweaters supposedly made the most of her firm and jutting breasts. Her first major feature picture introduced her as a sweater girl sitting at a soda fountain. MGM's publicity department churned out the story that an agent had discovered her cutting school in just such a setting and immediately saw her star potential. Just like that. Believe that if you can. Cheryl, it seems, does. And the public did. And MGM continued to put soda fountain scenes in several more of Lana's films. Lana finished her education in the upper grades of the MGM private school for child actors, where Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland were fitting the minimum of book learning into the last stages of their rich and turbulent adolescence, and where a little later Elizabeth Taylor would receive the skeletal outline of an education. Of the generation of female stars who lasted through the 40s and 50s, say, the era between the dominance of Joan Crawford and Betty Davis and the dominance of Marilyn Monroe and Elizabeth Taylor, Lana was, well, not so beautiful as Ava Gardner, not so subtly erotic as Rita Hayworth, not so coolly sophisticated as Lorraine Bacall, not so pertly memorable as Judy Garland, not so good an actress as Katharine Hepburn, not so simply sensuous as Jane Russell. But having listed them, and noted Betty Grable's dominance of the war years, one really has noted the stars who outshone Lana in the firmament. She was a lead lady, specialising in slightly shady girls for the first third of her career, sirens in costume dramas for the second. She was unlucky in the vehicles she found. Of all her movies, probably only The Postman Always Rings Twice could persuade one to stay up late watching it on television. And that more for the brilliance of James M. Cain's melodrama than for Lana's acting, despite her perfect casting as the murderous, desire-driven temptress. Histrionically, let me stress firmly, histrionically, I don't believe Lana Turner has ever had a murderous thought in her life off the screen. Along with the publicity about the kid playing hooky at the soda fountain, Lana garnered much early press coverage about her passion for nightlife. It suited the star-building publicists to have a just-within-bounds bad girl to feature. Lana, used by MGM for wild kid with big boobs roles, fitted this marketable image without any damage to her public following. But Lana was very young. By the time she was 18, she was supporting her mother, a stage and star-struck hairdresser who had married at 16 and was still in her early 30s. And Lana and Mom were living in luxury which neither of them could ever have anticipated when they abandoned Oklahoma and the feckless father who had abandoned them before himself being murdered on the streets by muggers who snatched his gambling winnings. Lana's head was turned by sudden wealth and the role of family breadwinner. With studio-appointed accountants and analysts to keep her money invested and her high spending covered by her earnings. Lana became a passionate nightclubber, and by the time she was 22 had raced through one brief marriage to the much-wed bandleader Artie Shaw and saw her name coupled in the press with a succession of handsome and famous boyfriends. Indeed, The gossip columnists doomily warned of a possible repetition of Clara Bow, the It Girl's fatal career of the 1920s, dragged to early death by drink and drugs. In fact, despite a growing taste for vodka, Lana Turner was never involved with drugs and kept her spinning life awkwardly balanced like a gyroscope. In 1942, she married the very good-looking, very charming businessman Stephen Crane. He was not especially successful in his business at that time, and some of his income seems to have come from gambling and other activities even nearer the line of illegality. But he was a popular escort for squiring the glamorous ladies of Hollywood around their favourite night spots, and Lana, as was her way, fell very, very heavily for him at first. They married twice. Both Nevada quickie weddings with a shirt-sleeved judge who would hitch tourists instantly for a fee. The first time was a typical young Lana spur-of-the-moment wedding. Equally typically, it was soon apparent that her dizzy love was not going to last, and the couple drifted into separation. But by then, Lana was pregnant, and Steve was drafted to the war. And it appeared that they had married before Steve's previous wife had fully completed the dissolution of his first marriage. Now there were possible publicity snags for them. Lana's baby might be illegitimate. Steve avowedly wanted to accept his role of father, and it would look very bad if Lana unpatriotically kept his baby away from him as he went off to war. Cheryl Crane was to be Lana Turner's only child, and she was born into a tangle of remarriage and separation and re-separation that somehow preserved her legitimate status that mattered so much to the public. Born also into the role of Hollywood princess, pampered daughter of a big star whose publicity insisted that being mama mattered more than anything else to her. In fact, Lana and her daughter rarely met by normal family standards. Lana was up and filming or abed sleeping off her nightclubbing when Cheryl arose. She was still out at work or off on her hectic social life by the time Cheryl was abed with her devoted nanny sitting under the nightlight. Let's be fair to Lana. She was very young to have so much money and responsibility for both her mother and a daughter. Her final separation from Steve Crane was difficult. Both vied for their daughter's affection and for custody of her. Lana won the custody battle easily. Steve won the affection battle on points, but his private life of drinking and gambling and women, even as he became the respectable and successful millionaire proprietor of a chain of pseudo-Polynesian restaurants, never made him look remotely like a responsible father. Lana was rather a remote goddess mother. Men moved in and out of her life, and Cheryl shifted between governesses and a succession of public and private schools, never really learned to relate either to her own age group nor to a stable domestic life. After Lana's relatively happy marriage to millionaire Bob Topping broke up, Cheryl resigned herself to the fact that stepfathers wouldn't last and she'd better not get too close to them. This didn't save her when she was 14, and Lana's third husband, the handsome Tarzan actor Lex Barker, habitually raped her and threatened her with removal to a home for juvenile delinquents if she breathed a word about it. Happily, the adult Cheryl has sensibly revealed this and named Barker's name. If all sexually abused daughters, stepdaughters, nieces and the like make a point of publishing the facts when they're grown up, so that the creeps who exploit their strengthened adult status to satisfy their lust on helpless children can expect to be exposed and despised in future years, we may hope to see this nauseating and all-too-common crime diminish. Fortunately, Cheryl told her governess, and Lana and her mother got rid of Mr. Barker in short order with a frightening flea in his ear. But they dared not expose Cheryl to the publicity that would come from bringing charges. Lana's next boyfriend knew about Barker's evil doing, and he was particularly careful to behave circumspectly with Cheryl. He gave her a horse and took her riding and was consistently friendly and amiable. But he was careful never to stray beyond the bounds of strict propriety. He was less discreet with Lana. He was, in fact, a sad symptom of the difficult phase Lana's life and career had reached. Television had asserted its decisive challenge to the great Hollywood movie-making machine, and the succession of undistinguished costume dramas in which Lana appeared were an optimistic commercial response, doing something bigger and more spectacular than the small black-and-white screen could manage. They did nothing for the popularity of an actress who was now in her 40s, whose days as a sweater girl were definitely over, whose standing as a leading blonde bombshell was decisively overtaken by the far more striking Marilyn Monroe. Lana's contract with MGM, which had kept her and Cheryl in luxury for 2 decades, was not renewed. She had to rely on independent filmmakers and her own business sense. And as her career looked shakier, her boyfriends got younger. She was in some danger of getting in the gossip columns as a cradle snatcher, and she was aware that this looked undignified. She was relieved when Johnny Stompinato assured her that he, too, was in his middle 40s. This, it transpired, was a lie. The handsome Italian-American was actually 10 years younger than Lana. But his good looks and macho style brought him admirers in Hollywood. And curiosity came into play, as it was reported that he was endowed with an organ the size of an Academy Award. Indeed, his mighty member was nicknamed Oscar. To Lana, as to others, this apparently seemed more attractive than uncomfortable. She started dating him, and characteristically fell headlong, if briefly, in love with him. Johnny was a dodgy lover for her to take on board. His life was led really close to the wind. He had been a bodyguard for the notorious Mickey Cohen, one of Cohen's tough and stocky seven dwarves. And although the press might euphemistically describe Cohen as a gambler, this was mere cover for his known position as a mobster. Nor was Cohen a mobster with the class of Bugsy Siegel, who had opened up Hollywood and later Las Vegas for syndicated crime. Siegel, when not actually in the berserk rages that gave him his nickname, was handsome, elegant, stylish, and a halfway passable imitation of a gentleman, at least by film actors' standards. Benny Blue Eyes, as his friend George Raft called him, and his starlet-turned-gangmole mistress, Virginia Hill, were an accepted part of the Hollywood social scene until his savage murder in Virginia's house. Mickey Cohen and his boys never had the same entree to the good life. Mickey was too obviously crude and ambitious. Indeed, he was a bit of a joke to the Hollywood inset. Stompinato ran some unsuccessful shops as cover for some nefarious activities, quite probably drug dealing. He made a practice of snuggling up to older ladies and getting his mitts on their savings. And he seems to have gone in for some nasty blackmail. Either he or an associate would take photographs of his lovers in compromising positions before he ended the affair with a demand for cash. He had a set of pictures of Lana sleeping naked on her bed, but he never got round to using them feloniously. In fact, he hoped to marry her, and thus gain the respectability that evaded him. And as I've said, compared with the legitimate Lex Barker, he really was a respectable and decent human being, at least in his conduct to 15-year-old Cheryl. 1958 saw Lana's comeback and disaster. She had sensibly accepted an older woman role in Peyton Place as the helpless mother of a difficult adolescent daughter. The film, with its rather silly lid-off small-town America hype, proved the great success of the year, and Lana won her only Oscar nomination for her performance. There was a future for her as a well-preserved older heroine of Weepies. But life with Johnny was growing more tempestuous. She wanted to break the affair off. He was determined not to lose the best chance he had ever had of a marital ticket to respectability. When they quarrelled, he hit her. He threatened her life. He behaved to her as no man ever had done before. Lana was terrified and did not know how to cope. Her life had been both exposed and sheltered since she was an adolescent, and she hadn't grown up to know quite how to stand on her own feet. She began using Cheryl as a defence, telling Johnny that he was waking the baby and he'd have to go. But Cheryl heard terrifying fights and terrifying threats made to her mother. It came to a head on Good Friday, 1958. Lana had told Cheryl that she really intended to break off with Johnny. Now she knew he was 10 years younger than her. Cheryl was doing homework in her room and half watching Bilko on television when she heard Johnny start a foul-mouthed row downstairs. Heard, too, his threat to cut up Lana's face. Lana deliberately led him into Cheryl's room to make her daughter the excuse for demanding that he leave. The row trailed out downstairs, and then Lana darted up to her own bedroom and locked the door. Stompinato was furious and violent. He battered the door, threatening to break it down until he was admitted. Cheryl went into her mother's room and brought her out with an excuse, and the two locked themselves in the bathroom. Lana admitted that she was terrified of her lover, but still something had to be done. Lana went back to the bedroom, and the row renewed. Cheryl broke in and interrupted it once when it seemed that her mother was being hit about the place. But when she left, Stompinato's threats renewed. He would cut Lana's face so that she'd never work again. He'd send the boys to mutilate her if she made him leave. Cheryl's adolescent mind went into overdrive. She decided she must frighten this violent man out of the house. She went into the kitchen and fetched a knife before going back to the bedroom. There, by tragic mischance, Johnny Stompinato had just lifted his coat on a hanger out of the wardrobe so that he was standing behind Lana with his hand raised. To the girl, it looked as if he was about to bash her mother. She pushed forward to hit him before he could. He saw her coming and moved toward her, and she hit him with the knife in her hand. She was holding it awkwardly with the blade upwards, and as she punched below the ribs, the blade sliced into Johnny Stompinato and curved up toward his heart. He was utterly astonished. Lana and Cheryl were appalled. They tried mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, but the one relatively small wound was lethal. Johnny died on the floor before the ambulance arrived, and the cops took Cheryl off to the juvenile hall Lex Barker had threatened her with. I well remember the newspaper sensation in America at the time and the endless moral abuse heaped on Lana Turner for associating with a gangster and endangering her daughter's morals. The abominable creep Lex Barker surfaced from retirement in Italy to say that Cheryl had always been difficult and his breakup with Lana had been prompted by unspecified lies the girl told. Lana and Steve came together to try and help Cheryl through the initial trauma, but there was not much they could do. Too many people were insisting that there must be no favoured treatment for a star's delinquent daughter. Cheryl actually risked the death sentence if the courts should decide that she could be tried as an adult for murder, and the police gloomily felt that there was no alternative but to press for the most serious charges in the light of all the publicity. Fortunately, the coroner's jury saw the incident as justifiable homicide, and the magistrates' courts, faced with Lana and Steve quarrelling once again over the custody issue, decided that the girl should be made a ward of court and put on probation under her grandmother's care and control. Cheryl had a difficult adolescence, since nobody told her that it was not her fault that all this adverse publicity had descended. She had no idea that no reasonable person would attach blame to her for the stabbing. And two other factors made things worse. Lana could only keep her career afloat by accepting roles which deliberately echoed the scandal. She was typecast as the incompetent mother with a delinquent daughter, possibly one who tried to share her boyfriend, thus precipitating tragedy. In fact, far from ever having wanted Johnny sexually, Cheryl came to realise that she was lesbian. Only this was still only the early 60s, when it wasn't yet obvious to civilized people that a homosexual orientation was completely unimportant and in no sense immoral. Cheryl was in and out of custody until her 20s, ending in a period in a mental hospital. But happily, all came well for her in the end. She succeeded as a property developer in Hawaii, partnered by her admirable gay lover of two decades. She came to good terms with a finely matured Lana, and she was told at last, in her 40s, that her attempt to defend her mother's life against an apparently violent man when she was only 15 was far from culpable. It was admirable. Today, Cheryl Crane is a strikingly beautiful, happy, and open-faced woman, quite different from the frightened and sullen teenager whose pudgy face scowled miserably at the photographer's flash bulbs in 1958, and who most people still assume murdered her mother's gangster boyfriend.